Hello friends, welcome to video series on geography. In this video, we'll see about the comparison between tropical cyclones and temperate cyclones. So before trying to understand this particular concept, you need to have a good understanding about the individual concepts of tropical cyclones as well as temperate cyclones. So if you are new to this channel, please watch my previous videos on tropical and temperate cyclones before watching this particular video. First, let us compare with the latitudinal extent in which these particular cyclones occur. We have tropical cyclones which occur between 5 degrees north and 30 degrees north, as well as 5 degrees south and 30 degrees south. So we have tropical cyclone formation in both the hemispheres, and the latitudinal extent varies from 5 degrees to 30 degrees north and south. So here we have Coriolis force, which is sufficient enough. Along with that, we have warm waters whose temperature would be around 26.6 degrees Celsius. And along with that, during particular seasons like during October in the Indian Ocean and during August, September in the Western Pacific, we have very low wind shear, which is conducive for formation of tropical cyclones. Coming to temperate cyclones, temperate cyclones only form in the middle latitude regions. This is where the warm tropical air masses and cold polar air masses converge. So this convergence of air masses gives rise to a kind of front called as occluded front. I've explained in detail what is occluded front. So occluded front is the primary factor behind the formation of temperate cyclones. So if you consider the latitudinal extent, they range from 30 degrees north to about 65 degrees north, and this is true in both the hemispheres. So even in southern hemisphere, we have tropical cyclones which occur between 30 degrees south and 65 degrees south latitudes. But when it comes to intensity, usually the northern hemisphere sees greater intensity of tropical as well as temperate cyclones. So the greater temperature contrast is the primary reason for higher intensity in temperate cyclones, whereas due to greater continental landmass in the northern hemisphere, we have greater temperatures in the northern part of the earth. As a result, the northern hemisphere has greater warmer waters, so warmness here is much higher. As a result, the tropical cyclone formation is dominant in this particular hemisphere. Coming to the origin, usually tropical cyclones have thermal origin, that is, they mainly are formed due to high thermal insulation or high sun's insulation. So sun's energy is the primary source, and based on that we have the formation of tropical cyclones. Whereas the temperate cyclones are mostly dynamically induced ones, where there are air masses which are converging, and this convergence gives rise to the formation of temperate cyclones. So we can say here the bigger factor is the dynamic ones, that is the movement of air masses, whereas in the tropical cyclone formation we have the temperatures which play the most important role. And the tropical cyclones occur only in oceans, whereas the temperate cyclones can occur both in oceans as well as on the continents. This is because we need to have great amount of moisture which is available only on the oceans. As a result, the tropical cyclones form only on the oceans, whereas when they make landfall, usually the moisture content is lost. So moisture supplies with latent heat of condensation, which is very essential for driving a tropical storm. So when it hits the land, or when it makes landfall, the latent heat of condensation is no more available. As a result, the storm quickly dies. Coming to formation, usually we don't have good amount of moisture content on the continents. As a result, the tropical cyclones don't form on the continents. So they form only in the oceanic regions. So coming to temperate cyclones. So temperate cyclones mainly form due to convergence of air masses from the tropics as well as polar regions. And these particular air masses can be converging over the continents, or they might be converging on the oceans. So we have temperate cyclones which form both on the continents as well as oceans. Coming to seasons in which they form, usually tropical cyclones form in late summers. In Indian Ocean, we usually see tropical cyclones in mid-September to till early Novembers, whereas in the Western Pacific, usually tropical cyclones or typhoons occur in the months of August as well as September. And hurricane season is also quite active during August and September. And in Indian Ocean, because of this half nature of Indian Ocean as well as the influence of southwest monsoons, etc., usually these cyclones form a bit later, that is in the mid-September to early Novembers. And tropical cyclones form only during summer, as we have seen. Whereas temperate cyclones form all around the year, but they are very intense in the winter seasons because of greater temperature contrast which exists in the winter seasons. So they are very strong in the winters and quite weak in the summer seasons. Coming to size and shape, we know that the temperate cyclones have a very irregular shape, and whereas the tropical cyclones have highly elliptical shapes. And coming to size, usually the tropical cyclones are quite smaller compared to the temperate cyclones. Usually temperate cyclones occur over a very vast area, usually ranging from 500 to 2000 kilometers in extent or diameter. This would be the horizontal extent of the cyclone, whereas the tropical cyclone usually has an extent of 300 to 500 kilometers only, and in very rare cases it would reach about 800 kilometers, and this happens only with very strong or supercyclonic storms. Coming to rainfall, we know that the temperate cyclones are formed due to occluded front formation. So occluded front involves a cold front and a warm front, and we have this particular warm air which is being uplifted. This is called as occlusion. So we have rainfall in both the warm front region and the cold front region. So if you look at this particular figure, we have rainfall all across this particular region where we see intense cloud formation. So this is the low pressure system of the cyclone, and we have rainfalls all throughout this area. So these are the two regions where we have intense rainfall in terms of temperate cyclones. Whereas in tropical cyclones, usually there is two regions. One is upliftment. The regions are called as rain bands. So these particular rain bands sees intense rainfall. So they are towering cumulonimbus clouds, and cumulonimbus clouds, we know that they facilitate intense rainfall. Whereas on the other side, we have the subsidence of air. So I've discussed all this in detail in the previous videos. So this subsidence is a region where we don't see any rainfall, and here we see very stable conditions. Especially there are different regions where subsidence is very intense. For example, in the eye region, subsidence is very strong, and here it is almost associated with very clear skies. Whereas in the eye wall region, usually we have the biggest cloud formation, which is the most intense cumulonimbus cloud, and this gives rise to very intense rainfall in the eye wall region. And along with that, we have spiraling rain bands which tend to move towards the central part of the cyclone, and these particular spiral bands are very important because they also give good amount of rainfall. Coming to the forces that drive these cyclones, usually the tropical cyclones receive the energy required in the form of latent heat of condensation, whereas the temperate cyclones, the energy received depends on the densities of air masses. We know that usually the tropics have warm air masses, whereas the polar regions have cold air masses, and the densities and temperature differences are very huge, and depending on the greater differences in temperature and other factors, usually the intensity of storm or temperate cyclone depends in the mid-latitude region. Whereas coming to the tropical cyclones, we have seen the primary factor that drives the tropical cyclones is latent heat of condensation. And coming to isobars are nothing but imaginary lines joining regions of equal pressures. So if you look at the isobar shape, we have this particular shape. It is in the shape of V. For example, we have temperate cyclones which look like an inverted V. So even the isobar shape is close to representing a V shape. So this is the region where we have different pressure systems. Usually the low pressure is associated with the combination of both warm and cold fronts. So the convergence zone of both warm and cold front is the region of low pressure, and it is not a closed pressure system like in the tropical cyclones. In tropical cyclones, we have a closed pressure system, which simply means that the pressure is quite different from the surrounding regions. For example, here the pressure is very, very low, whereas in the surrounding regions, the pressure is completely higher. And usually when the pressure contrasts are very rare, in such a case, we don't have a closed system. Whereas when the pressure contrast is much greater, in such a case, we see the formation of a closed pressure system. So this is the shape of isobars, and it is different for both tropical as well as temperate cyclones. So we have a V-shaped pressure gradient in the temperate cyclones, whereas we have a kind of closed system in the tropical cyclones. And coming to cloud formation, we know that in the temperate cyclones there are greater number of cloud types which are formed, whereas in tropical cyclones there are fewer number of clouds. So coming to tropical cyclones, we have mainly cumulonimbus clouds, that is the rain bearing clouds, and then we have nimbostratus clouds, which are very rare, comparatively rarer compared to the cumulonimbus ones. But still, these nimbostratus clouds are important because they are also rain bearing clouds. And the cumulus clouds form on the boundary of cyclone, and they don't bring good amount of rainfall. And on the top regions, we have something called as central dense overcast. It is formed by cirrus clouds. So these are high altitude clouds, where their altitude varies from 10 to 15 kilometers above the Earth's surface. So this particular region is very cold, where the water vapor exists usually in the form of ice crystals, hexagonal ice crystals. So cirrus clouds is the one which forms the cap of the tropical cyclones. And when it comes to temperate cyclones, we have the formation of usually the first clouds to be formed are the cirrus clouds, then they move towards the upper layers, and then we have cirrostratus clouds, and we have middle altitude clouds called as altostratus and altocumulus clouds, and then we have nimbostratus and cumulonimbus clouds at the later stages. So nimbostratus and cumulonimbus clouds are very important because they bring intense amount of rainfall during the formation of temperate cyclones, whereas cirrus clouds, as we have seen, they're very cold regions. And then we have mid-latitude clouds like cirrostratus clouds. So in tropical cyclones, we don't have the formation of mid-latitude clouds. We have the formation of only low latitude and higher latitude clouds. Whereas in the temperate cyclone region, we have cloud formation where we see almost all kinds of clouds exist in the cold and warm front regions. Coming to the path. So the path of temperate cyclones is influenced by jet streams. As a result, the jet streams, which are westerlies, that is, they flow from west to east, they influence the path of temperate cyclones. As a result, the temperate cyclones flow from west to east. Whereas tropical cyclones have a very strange behavior. It is different in different regions. For example, we have regions like Western Pacific and Western Atlantic, where we see the tropical cyclones follow a path east to west below 20 degrees latitude, and above that from 20 to 25 they follow a northward path, and after 25 to 30 degrees north or south latitudes they follow western path. So that is, they flow from west to east. So this, they typically follow a parabolic path. Whereas in Indian Ocean, we usually see first initially the eastward movement, and then they move towards north. This is because of the influence of monsoon winds. Whereas in the Atlantic and typhoon regions, the path is quite different. And coming to influence on India, usually both the cyclones have great influence on India, whereas the tropical cyclones have much higher influence compared to the temperate cyclones. So tropical cyclones bring rainfall to the eastern coast. So they are greater in number in Arabian Sea. As a result, the eastern coast is highly affected by tropical cyclones. And tropical cyclones are very important in bringing rainfalls to the region of Tamil Nadu and parts of Karnataka. So in this year, that is 2005, we didn't have any good formation of tropical cyclones in the Bay of Bengal. As a result, these particular states like Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu are facing drought-like conditions. This is because of lack of cyclone formation in the Bay of Bengal in this year. Whereas in the Arabian Sea, we had a cyclone called as Chapala. Usually these cyclones don't make landfall over India. They are very rare. Whereas they make landfall in Pakistan as well as sometimes in the Arabian regions. So usually they hit the coast of Gujarat and Rajasthan. When they hit this particular coast, they bring good amount of rainfall to this particular region. And most of the time they cause disastrous floods. So the eastern cyclones form disastrous floods in this particular region, like Hudud and Phelan, where Phelan caused very high amount of disaster in Orissa, and Hudud caused great disaster to the city of Visakhapatnam in Andhra Pradesh. Whereas coming to temperate cyclones, usually temperate cyclones are very important, which bring rainfall to northwestern India, and also they bring good amount of snowfall in the regions of Jammu and Kashmir and other parts of northern India, Himalayas. So usually the states of Punjab and Haryana are the biggest beneficiaries of this particular temperate cyclones, whose residual remnants of a particular cyclonic condition pass towards this region and cause intense amount of or comparatively good amount of rainfall to the Punjab and Haryana region. And this particular rainfall is very important because these states would have been deserts without this rainfall. Usually the southwestern monsoons, which flow in this particular direction because of Himalayas, bring very less rainfall because all the rainfall is exhausted in this particular region. So here the winds don't have significant moisture. As a result, as they move towards the west, the rainfall intensity decreases. Usually these southwest monsoons bring very slight rainfall to the regions of Punjab and Haryana, and western disturbances are the remnants of temperate cyclones which are forming over Mediterranean, Black Sea and Caspian Sea are important in bringing rainfall to the regions of Punjab and Haryana. So the specific term used is western disturbances. So we can see the V-shaped tropical cyclone temperate cyclonic disturbance over the states of Haryana and Punjab. So this is all about the comparison between tropical cyclones and temperate cyclones. So thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe.